The Wings of the Butterfly, A Tale of Amazon Rainforest, by Aaron Shipper. Printed in an early version in Australia School Magazine, March 1997, it also printed in Tricket, March 2007. Copyright 1997 by Aaron Shipper. It may not be published or posted without permission. On the banks of Amazon River, in a clearing in the forest, there once lived a girl named Shimashu. She dwelt with her family and relatives in a big pavilion house called Maloka. While the boys of Maloka fished and hunted with the men, Shimashu and the other girls helped the women with household chores or in the farm plots nearby. Like the other girls, Shimashu never stepped far into the forest. She knew how full it was of fierce animals and hateful spirits, and how easy it was to get lost in. Still, she would listen wide-eyed when the elders told stories about other world, and sometimes she would go just for a little way in, gazing among the giant trees and wondering what she might find farther on. One day, Shimashu was making a basket. She looked up and saw a big morpho butterfly. It was hovering right before her, some light tans on its shimmering blue wings. "You are the most beautiful magical creature in the world," Shimashu said dreamily. "I wish I could be like you." The butterfly dipped as if in answer, then flew toward the edge of the clearing. Shimashu sat down on her basket and started after it. Imitating its lazy flying, she goes and goes and goes among the trees, and she followed, swooping and circling and laughing and flapping her arms. She played like this for a long time, until the butterfly passed between some vines and disappeared. Suddenly, Shimashu realized that she had gone too far into the forest. There was no path, and the leaves of the fall trees made a canopy that hid the sun. She could not tell which way she had to come. "Mother, father, anyone?" she shouted, but no one came. "Oh no," she said softly, "how will I find my way back?" Shimashu wandered anxiously about, hoping to find a path. After a while, she heard a tap tap tapping. "Someone must be working in the forest," she said hopefully, and she followed the sound. But when she got close, she saw it was just a woodpecker. Shimashu sadly shook her head. "If only you were human," she said, "you could show me the way home." "Why would I have to be human?" asked the woodpecker indignantly. "I could show you just as I am." Startled but glad to hear it talk, Shimashu said eagerly, "Oh, would you? Can't you see I'm busy?" said the woodpecker. "You humans are so conscious. You think everyone else is here to serve you. But in the forest, listen carefully, a woodpecker is just as important as a human is." And the woodpecker flew off. "I didn't mean anything bad," said Shimashu to herself. "I just want to go home." More uneasy than ever, Shimashu walked farther and farther. All at once she came upon the maloka, and sitting within it was a woman weaving a hammock. "Oh, grandmother," cried Shimashu joyfully, addressing the woman with the term proper for an elder. I'm so glad to find someone here. I was afraid I would die in the forest. But just as she stepped into the maloca, the roof began to flap, and the maloca and the woman together rose into the air. Then she managed to saw it was really Tinamou bird that had taken a magical form. It flew to a branch above. "Don't you grandmother me?" stretched the bird. "How many of my people have your relative hunted and killed? How many have you cooked and eaten? Don't you dare ask for my help?" I need to fly away. "The animals here all seem to hate me," said Shimashu sorrowfully. "But I can't help being a human." Shimashu wandered on, feeling more and more hopeless, and hungry now as well. Suddenly, a sorb of fruit dropped to the ground. She picked it up and ate it greedily. Then another dropped nearby. "It just followed the monkeys," Shimashu told herself. "Then at least I won't starve." And for the rest of the day, she walked alone, eating any fruit they dropped. But her fears grew fresh as daily fate and night came to the forest. In the deep darkness, Shimashu saw the monkey's star climbed down and she hid herself to watch. As the monkeys reached the ground, each one changed to the form of a human. Shimashu could not help but gasp, and within a moment the monkey people had surrounded her. "Why, it's Shimashu," said a monkey man with a friendly voice. "What are you doing here?" Shimashu stammered. "I follow a butterfly into the forest and I can't find my way home." "You poor girl," said the monkey woman. "Don't worry, we will bring you there tomorrow." "Oh, thank you," cried Shimashu. "But where will I stay tonight?" "Why don't you come with us to the festival?" asked the monkey man. "We have been invited by the Lord of the Monkeys." They soon arrived at a big maloca. When the monkey lord saw Shimashu, he demanded, "Human, where have you gone uninvited?" "We found her and brought her along," the monkey woman told him. The monkey lord groaned and said nothing more. But he eyed the girl in a way that made her shiver. Many more monkey people had arrived, all in human form. Some wore animal costumes of bark cloth with wooden masks. Others had designs painted on her face with black juniper dye. Everyone drank from grounds full of manionic bird. Then some of the monkey people rose to begin the dance. With the monkey lord at their head, they marched in torchlight around the inside of the maloca, beating drums and shaking rattle sticks. Others sang softly or played bones flutes. Shimashu watched it all in wonder. She told her friend, the monkey woman, "This is just like a festival of my own people." Late that night, when all had retired to their hammocks, Shimashu was kept awake by the snoring of the monkey lord. After a while, something about it caught her ear. "That's strange," she told herself. "It sounds almost like words." The girl listened carefully and heard, "I will devour Shimashu. I will devour Shimashu." "Grandfather," she cried in terror. "What? Who's that?" said the monkey lord, starting from his sleep. "It's Shimashu," said the girl. "You said you are asleep. You would devour me." "How could I say that?" he demanded. "Monkey don't eat people." "No, that was just foolish talk of his mouth of mine. Pay no attention, please." He took a long switch of maniac bird and went back to sleep. Soon the girl heard again, "I will devour Shimashu, I will devour Shimashu." But this time the snores were more like growls. Shimashu looked over at the monkey lord's hammock. To her horror, he was not a human form, but a powerful animal with black spots. The lord of the monkey was not a monkey at all, he was a jaguar. Shimashu's heart beat wildly. As quietly as she could, she slipped from the hammock and grabbed a torch. Then she ran headlong through the night. When Shimashu stopped at last to rest, daylight had begun to filter through the forest canopy. She sat down among the root buttresses of a kapok tree and began to cry. "I hate this forest," she said fiercely. "Nothing here makes any sense." "Are you sure?" asked a tiny voice. Quickly, wiping her eyes, Shimashu looked up. On a branch of her kapok was a morpho butterfly, the largest she had ever seen. It waved at her with brilliant blue wings. "Oh, grandmother," says Shimashu, "nothing here is what it seems. Everything changed into something else." "Dear Shimashu," said the butterfly gently, "that is the way of the forest. Among your own people, things change slowly and are mostly what they seem. But your human world is a tiny one. All around it lies a much larger world, and you can expect it to behave the same." "But if I can't understand the forest," cried Shimashu, "how will I ever get home?" "I will leave you there myself," said the butterfly. "Oh, grandmother, will you?" said Shimashu. "Certainly," said butterfly. "Just follow me, okay?" It wasn't long till they came to the banks of the Amazon. Then Shimashu saw with astonishment that the boat landing of her people was on the other side. "I crossed the river without knowing it," she cried, "but that's impossible." "Impossible?" said the butterfly. "I mean," said Shimashu carefully, "I don't understand how it happened, but now how will I get back across? It's terrible." "That's simple, don't worry," said the morpho. "I'll change you into a butterfly." And it begins to chant over and over. "Blue drinks the shoe, wings of blue drinks the shoe, wings of blue drinks the shoe." Shimashu felt herself grown smaller, while her arms grew wide and thin. Soon she was fluttering and hovering beside the water. "I'm a butterfly," she cried. They start across the white water, their wings glistening in the sun. "I feel so light and graceful," says Shimashu. "I wish this would never end." Before long they reached the landing, where a path to the Maloka led into the forest. The instant Shimashu touched the ground, she was changed back to human form. "I will leave you here," said the butterfly. "Farewell, Shimashu." "Oh, grandmother," cried the girl, "take me with you. I want to be butterfly forever." "That would not be right," said the butterfly. "You belong with your people, who love you and care for you. But never mind. Now that you have been one of us, you will always have something of the forest with you." The girl waved as the butterfly flew off. "Goodbye, grandmother, goodbye. Oh, my cat." Then Shimashu turned home with a heart that had wings of a butterfly.